We are delighted to have with us today a very special person to bring us some very special and much needed remarks, given where we are at this period of time at the University of Cincinnati, in the city of Cincinnati, in the state of Ohio. To introduce our keynote speaker is Dr. Caroline Miller, our Senior Associate Vice President for Enrollment Management.
Thank you, Blue. Good afternoon, everyone. Luke Visconti is the CEO and founder of Diversity, Inc. He launched Diversity, Inc. as a website in 1997 and has guided it to its being a leading publication for diversity, ranked number one globally for total web traffic and social media reach. Diversity, Inc. has almost 900 Facebook likes and Twitter followers, and more than 250,000 email newsletter subscribers, and close to 200,000 who receive the publication in the mail. Luke also created Diversity, Inc.'s Top 50. You will find it in your bag today. It's the leading corporate diversity list. Entering its 15th year, the competition had more than 1,000 participants in 2014. He is responsible for the methodology and has utilized the data collected in the Top 50 process to develop Diversity, Inc.'s consulting and benchmarking practice, which has more than 60 companies as clients. Luke meets personally with more than 40 CEOs every year. A prolific writer and interviewer, Luke has over 300 articles and interviews and columns on the website, and his Ask the White Guy is the leading draw in Diversity, Inc. Luke also created the Diversity, Inc. Foundation, a 501c3, and donates more than 4% of Diversity, Inc.'s gross revenue to the foundation. The foundation has no administrative overhead, and no one draws a salary from it. Its services are all donated. The foundation primarily funds scholarships to the three schools where he has a seat on the board: Bennett College, a historically black campus; New Jersey City University, a Hispanic-serving campus; and Rutgers University. Since 2006, Diversity, Inc. Foundation has distributed more than $1 million. I think we could use Luke's help here. Luke also serves as a board member to the PhD Project and to Haku's Corporate and Philanthropy Board. Luke holds a bachelor's degree from Rutgers. He is a veteran, having served as a naval aviator for more than 8 years and an active duty officer for another 18 months in the reserves. He still serves as a member of the Chief of Naval Operations Executive Panel and has briefed three chiefs of naval operations on issues of diversity and inclusion. I had the pleasure this January to hear Luke speak and to meet him and have a brief conversation afterwards. I am sure that you will feel yourselves a little pushed today, maybe a bit out of your comfort zone, but will truly grow from what he has to offer it if it's anything like his January remarks to the College Board Colloquium. I give you Luke Visconti.
Good afternoon, everyone. Dr. Spencer, it's a real honor to be here with you, and I don't know how I follow Dr. Spencer. It's almost impossible to do that. I want to thank you for inviting me here. I didn't know what to expect, and I have to congratulate you. For the schools that I'm on the board of, and Rutgers has almost 70,000 students, we could not get 800 people together to discuss the subject of diversity, which is an embarrassment, but I'm telling you that because I think you should be very proud of yourselves for this remarkable turnout. I'm going to give you some comments about Cincinnati, about the general macro trend that I see in the United States, what's driving corporate America, and I'm going to finish up with some things that the university should be considering. But before I get to all of that, I want to tell you how I got here, because, I was speaking one time to a civil rights organization in New Jersey, and after I was done, a woman came up to me and grabbed my arm and said, "You did a fine job," and I said, "Thank you." And she said, "When I first saw your picture, I asked, now why on earth are they asking that white boy to come here and talk about diversity?" but you did a fine job. And I said, thank you. So it's, I think, you know, the elephant in the room, how am I here? And I have a biology degree from Rutgers. I realized in my sophomore year that I hated biology, truly despised it. In fact, when they made me a distinguished alumnus of the university, my first remark was to apologize to all of the other distinguished alumni for lowering our aggregate GPA by a full point. I applied to the Navy's flight program when I was a junior, and as soon as I graduated, I went to Pensacola, made it through aviation officer candidate school, made it through flight school, flew in the fleet, and this is how I ended up. The Navy is the reason I end up being involved with diversity. Towards the end of my sea tour, the Cold War was ending, and I realized that I'd better get back to the States. I was overseas, and I better start looking for a job because the Navy was going to shrink. So those of you who are veterans here know that there's a calculus that you do when you ask for orders. You ask for something that nobody wants to do, and odds are you'll get to do it in a place where you want to go. So I hate the winter. I never wanted to return to New Jersey for that reason. So I wrote down, I wanted to do recruiting, which nobody wanted to do, and I wrote down, there's five spots, I wrote down Los Angeles, San Diego, Houston, Dallas, Atlanta, and I penciled in Miami, a sixth choice. And I waited. This was 1987. There was no fax machines, no email, none of that. So I waited and waited, and finally my little envelope came. And I was on Guam. I open it up. I'm all excited. Where am I going to go? And it says New Jersey. So I was a little upset. I went to the Air Force Base. I took some leave. And I flew in the back of a cargo plane from Guam to Washington, D.C. to argue with the guy who hands out the orders. And he had a very easy reason for me. He said, you're from New Jersey, aren't you? And I said, yes. And he said, well, you don't think anybody who's not from New Jersey is asking to go there, do you? And I said, no. And he said, that's why you're going back to New Jersey. So on my way back to New Jersey, I called up my new boss, and I told her I was on my way, and she said, I'm very glad you called, because I have a job that's open. It's not for everyone. But if you want it, it's yours, and if you don't want it, no harm, no foul. It's your choice, which is a very unusual thing to hear in the military. So then she told me they needed a new minority officer recruiter. And I thought for a second while I was on the phone. I grew up in a household that didn't tolerate bigoted talk. My parents wouldn't tolerate it. And I was in a fraternity at Rutgers that had black brothers, Asian brothers, and Latino brothers, which was very rare in the late 70s. So I said, you know what, XO, I don't have to think about it. I'll take the job. And she breathed an audible sigh of relief. It must have been hard to fill that job. And so when I arrived at the office, I introduced myself around. And the interesting thing about the military is you could read who a person is. You're wearing things on your uniform that tell you what rank you are, where you've been, what you do for a living, all of those things. And so I'm walking around, and I bump into another aviator, which was, I didn't know there was going to be another aviator there. There was only supposed to be one per office. So I introduced myself. His name is Tony Cato. And he was sitting down. I said, Tony, didn't know you were going to be here. He said, well, I'm not really here. I'm only here temporarily. I'm leaving the Navy. I've resigned my commission. And I'm finishing up my MBA. Now, reading what he was wearing, he's a Naval Academy grad. He's a pilot, an aviator, another helicopter pilot just like me. He'd been overseas, been to sea. You could read all of those things. So he said, what are you going to be doing here? And I said, well, I'm the new minority officer recruiter. And he leaned back in his chair, and he went like this, and he said, I guess you were the best they could do. And I laughed. I said, yeah, thanks a bunch, Tony. And he goes, well, I'll tell you what. Would you like my help? He's, by the way, African-American. I guess I should have put that at the beginning of the thing. I said, I'd love your help, Tony. So we went for his last few months in the Navy to different events. And in the car, Tony Cato is a natural-born professor. And he would tell me about his experiences and how he was discriminated against. It wasn't the total conversation, but these were the things he'd include. And I'd say, oh, come on, Tony, you're being too sensitive. Oh, come on, Tony, it couldn't have happened that way more than once. Those kinds of denial things. But the problem for me was that Tony, otherwise, was so credible as he's one of the most credible men I've ever met. He's a man's man. He's still married to his wife, Barbara, over 35 years now, but he talked about Barbara in a way that you would want to be married. That's how well he talked about his wife. He talked about his then little boys, now successful grown men, in a way that made you want to be a father. I mean, it was really wonderful to hear him talk. He was a great officer. He was a great aviator. I learned through the grapevine that he had to ditch a helicopter at sea. And there's two engines on Navy helicopters, and when you lose one, you can end up in the water. He got his crew out and is going to taxi upwind to shut down the engine, and his co-pilot was going to stay with him, and he grabbed his co-pilot by the front of his flight suit and said, "You're getting out of this aircraft, and I'm going to taxi it upwind alone." And he did, and it sank with him on board, but he got out. So this is a man with total credibility to me, and yet I was denying him his experiences. And it dawned on me one day, we were in the car, he was driving, and we were talking about what we like to do in the car on long drives. Now, those of you who are baby boomers may remember the Chrysler K car. The government bought, I think, all of them and to keep Chrysler in business. And they all had a squeak in the front left dash. So, you know, so we're driving, it's squeaking, and we're talking about what we like to do on long trips. So we were talking, and he said, "I have a box of Martin Luther King's speeches on cassette tape in the trunk of my car, and especially if I'm feeling a little down, I'll pop a tape in." Now, this is before you could fiddle with your cell phone and text people while you're driving, and satellite radio, and any of those things, CDs, DVDs, none of that. And I looked at Tony, and I was wondering, are you trying to make a point with me? And he wasn't trying to make a point with me. That's what he does in the car on long trips. And it dawned on me that I was missing a lot of what I was seeing, right in front of me, that I was missing it. And it dawned on me that Tony was maybe the most credible man I've ever met, and I thought I had the imprimatur to deny him his own experiences. And that was a big wake-up moment for me. I remember it vividly. I remember where we were on the road. Tony and I talk every so often. He does not remember the conversation. He was just talking. He wasn't trying to make a special point with me. He was just telling me what he did in the car on long trips. And from that point on, I never looked at things the same way. It's still unfolding to me. I still learn. And part of the process of having over 25 years of higher education board experience is that I'm immersed in issues that you learn things from on a constant basis. And that's what keeps me happy in what I do. And part of the thing, I did charge you a speaking fee for this, not nearly what I normally charge, because I wanted to be here, but I donate 100% of that speaking fee through my own 501c3, and 100% of that money is there to fund scholarships for economically underprivileged kids. That's what I do. I'm the only person here volunteering. I'm not being paid for this. Only you are, right? So there's something to be said. I'm here. I am. Ask the white guy. That's my column. And I have a privileged place, I think, to a large part based because I am a white man and because I could walk into corporations and they don't expect what's going to happen next. And so I'm going to tell you how I see things and why this event is so important. Our country is in the middle of an enormous shift. Right after World War II, we had 8 workers per retiree. Today, the number is 4 workers per retiree. And by 2025, the number is going to be 3 workers per retiree. Now, I believe that civil and human rights are not granted until the group that's demanding them has enough economic power to demand and receive those rights. And if you think about all of the civil rights progress in this country, it's all tied back to that. Rosa Parks was not a simple seamstress who one day decided to not go to the back of the bus in Montgomery. She was an activist, and this was planned. And there was a woman before Rosa Parks who didn't want to get up and go to the back of the bus, but the local civil rights organization said she's not spotless enough. She was a single mother, which when you think back in the 50s was a tough thing to be. They waited for Rosa Parks to do it. And the reason they won is because they brought the bus company to its knees
economically. So if you think about what happened in the late 50s and the 60s, it wasn't that all of a sudden white people felt beneficent to black people and said, you know what, we're going to go ahead and do that Civil Rights Act and Voting Rights Act. No. It was protests, worldwide humiliation, photographs in the worldwide press. JFK dabbled in it. It was LBJ who made it happen. And if you read the there's a lot of history, and LBJ is a wonderful president. He was able to negotiate the Civil Rights Act and Voting Rights Act, which gave us these fundamental rights in our country. There was another thing that he was able to negotiate, which was immigration reform in 1965. Before 1965, there were non-white quotas on immigrants. Non-white quotas. And if you want to look up a particularly disgusting part of our history, look up the Asian Exclusion Act and the Chinese Exclusion Act, things that lived with us right up until that era. So if you think about this nation being a nation of immigrants, not so fast. It was a nation of certain kinds of immigrants, other ones not so fast. You had to wait. So here's where I think we all are today. Now, if you think about our workforce aging and us going from 8 workers per retiree to 4 workers per retiree to 3 workers per retiree, what else happened since the Civil Rights era? Well, I looked up to see what the workforce looked like in 1960. And I found that it was 21% women. It's roughly half women now, both college educated and non-college educated. So what were those 21% women doing in 1960? I couldn't find the exact statistics on this. I'm sure that almost all of them were school teachers, nurses, admin workers, domestic workers, etc. Do you know that despite the fact that 10% of our country, a little over 10% of our country at the time was black, that I could not find statistics for black workers in the economy? The government wasn't collecting them. I have a theory. I have a theory on this. The one compromise that FDR had to make to get the Social Security Act passed in 1934 was to Southern senators. He had to exclude 2 categories of workers, home domestic workers and farm workers. So think about this. That categorized probably 99% of the black workforce in the South at the time. Now, if you're in the South and you have a farm or a plantation, and I don't have to take care of my grandmother and grandfather, but you have to take care of yours, and you have to work because the minute you stop working, you stop getting paid, and there's no way your old folks are going to get money to sustain them in their old age, I have an economic advantage, and you have an economic disadvantage. Think about that. So if you think about the government in 1960, they couldn't care less about black people because they weren't paying into the Social Security Fund. It's money that drives all of this. And I'll tell you what else is driving today, the Affordable Care Act. Now, if you look at today's workforce and you add up black, Latino, Asian, and women, it's 88% of our workforce. And then if you think about people with disabilities who happen to be the number one highest unemployed group of any college-educated group in our country, and you, but there's some of them that are employed, and you add in LGBT people, you could see that we're already, and now it's double counting women, the 88%, we're already majority minority workforce. Now here's a kind of interesting thing. Did you know that most of the people, most, more than half, of the people without health insurance in this country are black and Latino? So I look at the government, which consumes a great deal of what we do, and I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a businessman, I'm well over 50% in the tax bracket, well over 50%. I pay about $17,000 a week in taxes. And so I look at things with a very jaundiced eye in terms of the government's intent, and I would tell you that the only intent the government has is money, and I know that because if I miss my quarterly payments to the IRS, I get a phone call immediately. Nothing else in the government works like that. I will immediately be contacted and say, Mr. Visconti, you're one of our best customers. Are you okay? So let's think about the Affordable Care Act. If you're a mother and you're at home and your child is running 104 temperature and you don't have health insurance and you can't go to the doctor, are you going to work today? No. You're so far down Maslow's hierarchy that you're almost immobilized. You can't even think of what to do. Well, we're at a crossroads because of the aging of our workforce. where we need folks to now come into the workforce. But we're torn. We're torn the way business is torn, between the old way we make money and the new way we make money. What's the old way they made money at Kodak? Film. Do you know that if you go into Kodak's lobby, the world's first digital camera is sitting there in a glass case? They invented it. But the film people were making the money, and from what I understand, there were fistfights in the conference rooms while they were arguing. I mean, it's serious stuff. Let's go digital, let's go digital. No, film, film, film. And it was too late. They went bankrupt. It was too late when they switched. They're out of bankruptcy now. They're fine people. They do a wonderful job on diversity. But I wanted to just illustrate the tear between how we do business now and how we need to do business in the future. Think about this. We imprison more people per thousand than anywhere else on Earth. In fact, we imprison more than anybody by a factor of 6 to 1. More than half of our prisoners are black and Latino. We've been fighting a war on drugs for over 40 years. Nobody fights anything for 40 years unless somebody's winning, right? Who's winning? Well, the people who run the prisons, including for-profit prison companies. Now, what's another feeder aside from the war on drugs? And by the way, drugs are more plentiful and less expensive than ever before. And you know, you've all heard about the heroin, the rise of heroin usage. Did you know we spent 10 years in Afghanistan building roads and bridges in the place that grows almost all of the heroin on the planet Earth? You can't make this stuff up. You can't make it. War on drugs. The gun manufacturers, the people who make those black uniforms, the body armor people, every podunk police department has a SWAT team. We read about these things every day where people, they could have just waited and turned off the water to the guy in the apartment, but no, they blast him full of holes. That terrorist in Boston, we wanted to talk to that guy. Making him look like a colander wasn't the best way to do law enforcement. That's who's winning the war on drugs. Finally, and this is directly to you in Cincinnati, the public school system for most brown and black children is nothing more than systemic child abuse. And so why would we keep things this way? Well, if you don't think you need those black and brown children in your workforce, you give them bad schools. So you have schools and you have Section 8 housing and you have all of this stuff, this economy that swirls around poverty. And then you give them a war on drugs and then you have nice prisons for them. And by the way, the few that escape, don't let them have health care because that way we can keep the lid on them real good. That is where we are. Now this city, a person, a senior executive from a large company in this city said, I have to re-recruit my people every day because of Cincinnati. I don't know if you've ever read Enrico Moretti, who's a professor, wrote a book, The New Geography of Jobs. And he goes through a lot of data to show that certain cities are growing in percentage of college graduates, and other cities are maybe growing, but not nearly as rapid a rate. And he tracks everything down to economics. And guess what? In those cities that are winning, salaries are up, even for non-college educated people. Economy's robust. For cities like this, where there aren't growing at the same pace as other places, like Silicon Valley, for example, you're in trouble. You know, it's like the baby boomer thing. There's a whole lot of analogies now that you have to start throwing out. Otherwise, I really am the oldest guy in the room. In a lot of places, at 54, you end up being the oldest person in the room. But remember the old black and white TVs? And they'd shrink down to a little white dot and then go away? That's what's going to happen to a lot of cities in this country. And so I would ask you, now I would assume that the students here end up staying here to a large degree, but to your students who leave Cincinnati to go elsewhere for college, how many return? Not many. So think about the situation that you're in, the way we used to do business, and how we need to do business now. Now, there's this conflict, and you're at the crossroads of how you resolve this conflict. And I want to give you some insight on managing diversity which I'm impressed with, by the way, the number of chief diversity officers you have in your colleges, and a campus-wide chief or university-wide chief diversity officer, the emphasis your president and your board places on this, it's really impressive. I have to say that it's not often you see this kind of emphasis, and I'm glad to see it, because here in lies the future of our entire nation. And I'm going to give you some examples of what I think can be done, and I think I'm not as familiar as I could be about your university, but perhaps some of these ideas will translate. One of the things that you do when you're managing diversity, and by the way, our survey has over 300 fields, and we ask corporations very invasive questions. And we're very metrics-driven. We evaluate everything on SAS. There's over 183 different comparisons we do to create the list. Some of the comparators are nested, so there's more than 183 variables. And it's a totally editorial process. On the top 10, there's a company that doesn't do business with me. Hurts my feelings, but that's the way it is with an editorial process. But these companies give us all of this data for reputational purposes. They are all desiring to hire the best and brightest. They value differences as advantages. And so, especially when you look at company 15 and up, you're seeing companies that are very, very aggressive on this. Now, what are the things that you need to do to manage this aggressively? You have to hold people accountable. And I'll give you a great example. PricewaterhouseCoopers was approaching more than 25% turnover. And I heard this directly from their CEO. And I didn't know this when he told me, but apparently there's sanctions in Sarbanes-Oxley for accounting, big four accounting firms that have more than 25% turnover. So no CEO of a big four accounting firm wants to be on the front page of the Wall Street Journal for that reason. So he investigated who was leaving and why they were leaving. And as it turns out, it was women that were disproportionately leaving. And guess why? By the way, my wife says if men bore 50% of the children, that these problems would be solved a long time ago. But when you're going up for partner, which is the thing in your career, if you don't make partner as an accountant at a big four accounting firm, your career is over. Well, at the same time, that's when professional couples have children. So women have to make a choice. And the choice was, I'm going to quit, or I'm going to go to another firm where I perceive the ability to have a child and have a family. So what Bob Moritz did was, he measured what was going wrong. He found that the women that were leaving were doing mostly rote accountancy work and rote audit work. He had a group of retirees in Tampa that were pounding the table to do something. They have to retire at age 60 at all of the big four accounting firms. So he opened up an office in Tampa, was able to offload that the work that the women who were going to go on maternity leave and go for a period of time and leave, their work would go to Tampa, so their colleagues in the individual office wouldn't be burdened with it. And then he gave the managing partners a scorecard, and he gave them training, and he said, if the scorecard doesn't go in the right direction, you're reassigned. And that's a pretty heavy-duty thing when you think about firing a managing partner. Well, guess what? The numbers turned in the right direction. So what are the other things that these successful companies do? I didn't want to do PowerPoint today because, frankly, I'm sick and tired of PowerPoint. I don't know about you, but when I do PowerPoint and I'm here, I will put a picture of the most close country club to this geography. So for those of you who know what that is, you can keep it to yourself. But I put the picture up and I say, what's that? People don't know. And I say, that's the country club closest to here. You know what else it is? It's a resource group for very wealthy white people. And that's what it is. And there's nothing wrong with that. But employee resource groups, which have charters, are business focused, have quarterly report outs, have executive sponsors from the CEO's direct reports, are extremely successful, and they correlate to successful results in human capital. In fact, having a charter for your resource group is the number one correlation to success as measured as expressed in human capital. The other thing is structured mentoring, so that you're not doing ad hoc mentoring, because guess what? People will find, I was at a small engineering firm. There was 18 people on the executive committee, two black men, two white women, all the rest were white men. And one of the black men came up to me and said, would you please talk about formal mentoring? And I said, why? And he said, every black employee in this firm comes to either me or him to be their mentor. We can't do it all. So as luck would have it, it was a U-shaped room, and one side of the U was all white men. So I walked over to them and I said, any of you fellas mentoring any black people? And they all looked at each other and they shook their heads no. And I said, well, you don't have anything against mentoring black people, do you? I mean, the CEOs in the room are like, oh, no, of course not, you know. So I said, well, you got to structure this. So if you look at another best practice, structured mentoring, where you evaluate the outcome of the mentor and the mentee, and you assign a number to it. And by the way, Sodexo, which is at the top of our list, says they get a $1.22 return on investment for every dollar invested in structured mentoring. And then finally, an executive diversity council with teeth. Someone who could set goals and hold people accountable and make sure people are fired when things don't go right. Now, I will tell you that that catches people's attention. And I grew up Catholic, and I have a Catholic analogy for this. The nuns would teach us that you would be forgiven for your sins if you confessed to God and asked for forgiveness for one of two reasons. One, that you were sorry you offended God. And the second was that you were afraid of the punishment. You were afraid of going to hell. And the nuns would say, God would prefer the first reason, but we'll accept the second one. So your management of this has to be absolute, has to be metrics driven, and you have to give people the ability to grapple with a system that doesn't look like them. And if you don't do that, you will have the same outcome over and over again. And I think that this happens, and it's a difficult thing. There are a lot of really well-meaning white men who run these corporations. There's nothing wrong with being a white man. Some of my best friends are white men. But there's very well-meaning white men, and they will reject that you have to structure these things because they're not bigots, they're not homophobes, they're not misogynists. They're not. And they reject that you have to structure these things because it doesn't sound right to them. That's called white privilege. That's why I was able to deny my friend Tony Cato his very experiences, because I had this white privilege. You have to get past that. And I know, and I have my speaking engagements, usually the audience looks like this, where I am not in the majority in the audience. And so I have to tell you that you have to give the white men around you the psychological space to move in the right direction. And so it's something that you have to be thoughtful about. It's something that's disagreeable for me to even talk about, but it's necessary to get that movement. And a lot of times it's helping a person come to an epiphany, like Tony Cato came to me and gave me an epiphany. He persisted with me. He was my friend. He bore honest witness, and it changed my mind. And sometimes it is that epiphany. Sometimes it's getting somebody in touch with an epiphany they've already had. And I'm seeing this now, by the way, with gay rights issues. It's very interesting. I happen to have a small piece in ending Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Admiral Mullen put me on the Chief of Naval Operations Executive Panel, and I was driving home one summer afternoon when he was Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, and I got a phone call. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't answer the phone on Friday afternoons, especially in the summer, unless it's my wife, because it's not somebody calling me up with a good thing. It's somebody calling me with a stinking pile of nonsense that I can then worry about until Monday. I don't know what sadistic things people get in their hearts to punch that cell phone and let's get Luke on the phone and say, oh yeah, the wheels fall off of this one. Thanks a bunch. It's Friday at 5 o'clock. Now what? I'm going to sit here and not sleep until Monday. So I see it's a 202 number. I have important responsibilities on this panel. I pick up the phone. And it's a retired admiral friend of mine who said, Luke, when are you going to go see the chairman to talk about ending Don't Ask, Don't Tell? So it's a great idea. How am I going to get an appointment with the chairman? And the admiral said, Luke, he likes you. Just call him. He'll take your call. So I thought about it. And on Sunday, I emailed him and said, I'd like to talk with you about ending Don't Ask, Don't Tell. He emails right back. He was on his email. He goes, yeah, I come in. I need to talk to you. So I took him through all the demographics. And here was his epiphany. At the end of the hour, I said, Admiral, the statistics are the statistics. They all point in the same direction. But here's something that between you and I, I knew gay people when I was on active duty, and I am sure you know gay people right now who are on active duty. When are we going to start taking care of our shipmates? And he leaned back in his chair. And another meeting process, he goes to Congress and says, I think it's immoral to ask people to lie about who they are when they volunteered to serve our country. Now that's clarity. That's giving somebody, that's hearing somebody who's had an epiphany, a good person who could now put their goodness into good work. So I'm afraid for those of you, I want to close with one final thing because there's something else that I think all of you are in touch with, but let me enunciate it so that you can have this in your minds when you're talking to other people. There is a real difference between poverty and not poverty. Poverty forces you down Maslow's hierarchy and gives you impermanence as a permanent situation. You never know where you're going to be living. You may be living in the same place tonight, you may not be. You may have food today, you may not be. Now, all of these things compile onto people and they crush them and lower their ability to cope, lower them down Maslow's hierarchies, does not extinguish their potential one bit. So when you see things, and the difference between people who are impoverished and people in middle class struggle to develop a sense of permanency. We have brick houses and we look at heredity. And I had Skip Gates at one of my events who proved through DNA that he's Irish. And I'm like, okay, Skip, go hail a cab. We're in New York. Point uptown and try to get a cab. You're still black. I don't care how Irish you think you are. But that is a sense of permanency that he's trying to build in his life. And so middle class people build this permanency and poor people can never do it. So what is the difference when you bring poor students to campus? What do you need to do? I'm going to tell you about a Rutgers program that if you're not in touch with this, I will put you in touch with this. I've donated a lot of money to it and the people running it are magnificent people. It's called Rutgers Future Scholars. We take eighth graders and we take them 50 each from our four campuses, Camden, New Brunswick, Newark, and Piscataway. Now Piscataway is kind of a mixed industrial and community, satellite community. It's not very poor. Camden's horrible. Newark's worse. New Brunswick's pretty bad. Those three schools average roughly 40% graduation rate and single digits go on to higher education. So we take 200 a year. There's 1,000 kids in the program. Our first class graduated last year. 198 out of the 200 graduated and more than 100 ended up academically qualifying to go to Rutgers where they get a free scholarship. I have one of the kids in my office, Jason Gaines, and I'll give you kind of, and I think all of you could tell a story like this, but allow me to tell this so you could illustrate this. I get an email, I was at a corporate event in the summer, Jason was going into his junior year in high school, I'd known him since he was a little eighth grader, he's a very outgoing young guy, he's a great guy, he's going to make a great attorney or businessman someday. Bottom line is, Jason's mom's dead. Now I know his father's in prison, and I know his mom's in her early 30s, she's dead. So I get him on the phone, and I found out his grandparents were coming up from Georgia. They wanted to take him back and have him live in rural Georgia to finish high school. So I get him on the phone, and I tell him how sorry I am, and I say, so what's going on? And he tells me about his grandparents, and I said, well, do you want to go to Georgia with them? And he shouted into the phone, no, I will lose my scholarship. This is what was on his mind. And I said, so what's your immediate concern? You have no place to live, is that it? And he goes, I don't know what I'm going to do. So I said, Jason, do you have a bank account? And he said, yes, Mr. Colson, another businessman who donates money to this program, set one up for me. So I said, get me the bank number. You will have money in your bank account tomorrow morning, and Mr. Colson, I'd do this myself, but I'm not home. Mr. Colson will come and pay your rent. You don't have to go anywhere. We will find you a foster home and you will graduate New Brunswick High School, which he did, and he academically qualified to get into the business school. Now this program mentors these kids 12 months a year. I'm going to give you another story. How am I doing on time? All right, I got to wrap it up. But you know what? I flew here. I could fly home anytime I want to, so I'm going to stay. No. I was personally responsible for Rutgers getting a Navy ROTC unit. before all my editorial roundtables, I have the kids speak for themselves and tell their story. This big kid gets up, and I didn't know him. He was from Newark. I didn't know him. And he said, he gets up, big football player-sized kid, and says, "I am a foster child. I've been in foster homes since my earliest memory. I've never felt like I've belonged anywhere. And I've gotten to this program, and I didn't think I belonged here either, so I quit. And Dr. Moore, who's a professor on the Newark campus, came to my middle school and persuaded me to come back in. Then he started crying." We were all crying, because this big kid's crying. And he said, "For the first time in my life, I feel like I belong someplace." Now, he graduated. He's at Rutgers, too. The admiral, I had the chief of naval personnel with me. The admiral leaned back in his chair and said, "You know, I'm starting 3 ROTC units, but I'm going to pull the plug on one of them because I don't like the campus." I said, "Would you like to meet with the president of Rutgers?" He said, "Absolutely, sooner rather than later." 3 weeks later, he was in Dick McCormick's office. We now have that ROTC unit. It's worth millions of dollars to Rutgers because of the testimony. So I want to close by telling you the most remarkable thing about this program. Now, these kids had a sense of permanence. They had a sense of community. This was the only sense of permanence and community in their lives. So they come to Rutgers, more than 100 of them. Do you know what they did? They formed their own organization on their own, got it officially recognized, elected officers to keep that sense of permanency. Do you see what I'm saying? You cannot expect kids coming from poor situations to behave the same as middle-class kids. You have to nurture them. You have to give them that sense of safety so that we can overcome everything that they've come through. I turned to Jason. We were discussing his first semester grades, which were pretty good, B pluses, but no S's. And I said, "You got to get some A's in there. I know you're in the business school. I know it's tough." He goes, "I know I will." I said, "Because where are you going to go to get your MBA? And he looked at me. He goes, "I don't know, Rutgers?" And I said, "No, you're going to go to Wharton or Harvard, because those are the two best places, because they're an alumni association, for you to get an MBA. And he looked at me. He goes, "Do you really think I belong at Harvard?" And I said, "Jason, Harvard's dying for you. A kid with your experiences and your grades, they'd love to have you on campus." So he went out of my office thinking Harvard. You have to develop that program, and you have to nourish your kids who come here, who come from underprivileged backgrounds, because they are fighting, and I'm going to go back to the beginning of this. They are fighting the way this country does business now. Everything that Dr. Spencer fought for, we're still fighting for today. These horrible public schools. Do you know that your city is choking itself? Who's going to hire these kids coming from your crappy public schools in the inner cities? Who? Nobody. And they're going to end up just making this city not be one of Enrico Moretti's cities that's growing. So you've got to take a look and look inside and say, how do we become an element of continuing the path that Dr. Spencer set us on and vanquishing these public schools that serve nothing but this prison industrial complex and this war on drugs, this defeatist thing that, if we allow it to persist, will kill this country, kill it dead. We cannot age out and have 3 workers per retiree and maintain an inner city that's full of people who can't find jobs because they're not qualified for the jobs. Governor Romney wasn't wrong when he talked about the 47%. Now, he could have phrased it in a way that was palatable and not offensive. And I want to lend one last thing to you, because you're going to talk about red state and blue state. Do you know the electorate is going to be less than half white by the end of this decade? It's over. Governor Romney got 88% white people voting for him, 42% women. His largest demographic was 65 and older. The president, who was presiding over the worst economy since 1934, largest demographic was 18 to 29-year-olds, and his statistics looked amazingly like the millennial generation. 56% white. More than half women, by the way. It's over for that negativism. It can't survive. Which is why you're hearing this stuff in our news cycle, whipped up to a froth. Because Karl Rove and the Koch brothers have one last shot. and they're going to give it all they got. I get the hate every day, dozens and dozens and dozens of specifically driven hate messages with the same talking points in them. Don't let yourself be fooled and think that this is random. It's not. It's being funded by billionaires. Now, why would billionaires question the president's birth certificate? Why would billionaires be against people having affordable health care? Oppression is why. They like things the way they are. They want to keep doing business this way. It'll kill our country. Don't let them do it. Get up. Go to work. You guys have a great head start on almost all the universities I've ever seen. And so congratulations. Thank you for inviting me. It's been a real pleasure. And it's an honor to breathe the same air as you, Dr. Spencer. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that.
Well, Luke, again, welcome to the University of Cincinnati. Thank you so much for coming. We really do appreciate you answering the call. And I do want to say that we got the friends and family discount, so we do appreciate that. You did give us a lot to think about. We'll be digesting it and probably talking about it throughout the remainder of the conference, if not the remainder of our school year. So thank you again so very much. Please accept this as a very modest token of our appreciation.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it being here. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.